This is Duke University.
Now an official welcome to Duke University Chapel, what James B. Duke called the towering church, and a building that was, whose chief designer and architect was a black architect from Philadelphia, Julian Abel. This morning, we have the privilege and really a sacred moment to hear in commemoration of the 50th year of the matriculation of the first black undergrads, to hear from some of the voices, some of the music, from some of the firsts here at Duke University. The music you just heard lifted was from Ms. Alma Mickens Jones, who is a Trinity graduate, 1969, who did a degree in vocal music education, and she is currently here at Duke as the Director of Financial and Payroll Services for the Division of Student Affairs. And before I introduce our panelists, Ms. Jones will offer a special musical tribute once again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Jones. That piano will never be the same again. I'm a living witness. Now to our panelists. Our new day begun. Our panelists this morning are here to reflect on the past, the present, and the future, and to throw into the mix of their reflections, thinking about the role that their own religious faith played in the past, present, and the future. Just from my, starting from my left, and this is in your program, we have Dr. Onye Akwari, who was the Duke School of Medicine's first black professor of surgery, 1978, and he's representing the medical world of Duke. Coming closer, we have Dr. Caroline Lattimore, who was Duke's first black dean of minority affairs within student affairs, and the first black assistant provost, 1978. And Duke does not want to let Dr. Lattimore go because she is back, at least on a temporary basis. Closer in, we have Ms. Wilhelmina Rubin-Cook, one of the first five African-American undergraduates at Duke, who was a Trinity graduate in 1967. So she was one of the first undergraduate students here, 1963, and we have some others in the audience here with us today, Mr. Nathaniel Cook, and I believe also Mr. Gene Campbell, am I right? Oh, yes, Nathaniel White, excuse me, yes. But we also have some other firsts with us of the undergraduate class today. And closer in, we have the Reverend Dr. Clarence G. Newsom, who is Duke's first black football player on an athletic scholarship in 1972, and that was also along with Ernie Jackson. He was one of the first black athletes to be named to the ACC All-Academic Team, and he's currently a university trustee at Duke. So can we welcome all of our distinguished panelists? I'm going to raise a few questions that have to do with the past, present, and future, and allow them time individually to share their reflections. They realize it's not an entire sermon that they will be giving this morning, but a conversation starter for us as we will open up the floor for Q&A later in our morning session. Here are some of the questions that I invite you to reflect upon. What brought you to Duke, and what joys and challenges did you have during your time at Duke, and what role did your faith play during those joys and challenges? And that's the past. As it relates to the present, how would you assess Duke, the wider community, and the nation as it relates to race relations? And how does religious faith factor into all of this? And then in terms of the future, what are your hopes and dreams for the future of Duke University in the next 50 years as it relates to race and racial reconciliation. Whoever would like to begin? You know, those are small questions. I realize that.
Well, but maybe I'll take a stab at the first one and then pass the mic on. The mic is right here by me. Good morning to everyone. It's so good to see so many, many faces I've not seen in years. What a blessing it is for me to be here. What a lot of people don't know about me and my Duke experience is that I fell in love with Duke when I was 13 years old in 1963. I was watching a Duke football game and I saw Jay Wilkinson running the ball, and there was just something about the experience sitting in my parents' den all by myself that ignited a love affair. But in 1963, there was no reason for me to really pin any great hope on ever coming to Duke. So I just tucked it away. I never said anything to anybody about it. It was just there in my secret place. I was fortunate enough to be a starter on the football team my freshman year. And so by my sophomore year, West Point had found me in northeastern North Carolina, and they began to write to me. By the spring of my junior year, Duke found me, and a recruiter showed up in Ahoskie, North Carolina, the first and only time he ever got there, and hardly no one ever went to Duke from that part of the state. And it turns out that Duke kept up his interest along with some other schools. So for me, it came down ultimately to two schools, Wake Forest and Duke, because Wake Forest really made a point of letting me know they really wanted me. There was a time when I could not play either football or basketball and someone from Wake Forest not be there. But my heart was on Duke. I came to visit Duke. I met my dear friend Bill Turner, and we had a wonderful time out doing my recruitment visit, because during that time they gave recruits cars. And we had a black Volkswagen. And thank God we got around Durham without getting a ticket or getting in trouble, because that was before I was converted. In either case, in terms of my faith, I had a wonderful visit, but I wasn't certain about Duke because Duke wasn't quite as emphatic as Wake Forest was. So I ended up telling the coach at Wake Forest I was going to come there, but then I said to myself, if the head coach from Duke shows up here at my house, I think I'm going to go to Duke. And sure enough, 3 days before Christmas, he came to my house, which then created a big dilemma for me, because I told the coach at Wake Forest, Coach Tate, I was coming there. I went into deep prayer after that visit. I really did. I remember praying, several days, perhaps an hour or more, and finally came to the conclusion that my love was Duke and I was going to declare it, found the nerve to tell Coach Tate. And I came here really, really on faith, because the spring of my senior year, in high school, my very best friend during recess got in my ear one day under a tree. We were sitting on a bench. I never will forget it. I was ready to laugh as hard as I could because I knew he was coming forth with just a crazy joke. But he got right in my ear and whispered, "You will not last a half semester at Duke." And I came to Duke thinking, well, that might prove to be true, especially after I got into calculus and chemistry and some other things. This place, this chapel, became my anchor. And I made a point of attending here very regularly. But those first few months and all were so trying and so difficult, being a part of a team where guys hardly ever spoke to you, or you know the story, that I began to second guess it. And I remember telling myself one day, well, you made the decision to come. It was nobody's decision but yours. But I remember about three quarters of the way back on this side of the aisle one Sunday morning at the time of the closing hymn, I remember I stopped singing. And I had sung all through high school, had traveled across at least the first half of the nation singing in quartets. I stopped singing. At least I stopped developing my voice. I decided in particular I would never again use my bass voice, because if I did that, somebody might see me. This is like Maya Angelou stuff. I really did that. I felt that I could create a certain level of invisibility that would allow me to get through here. That Ralph Ellison stuff, it was a strategy. And then later, in the dining hall over here one day, I didn't have any sugar for my tea, and I decided I would drink it anyhow because I was thirsty. And then having done that, I decided that thereafter I would only drink bitter tea, and that would help me manage the taste of the bitterness of Duke University. And for many, 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 many years, I never drank sweetened tea as a result of that. It's been really rather recent. And my faith got me through, and the university minister at that time, Howard Wilkinson, was very, very key. I tore my knee up against the University of Virginia my sophomore year, and I was trying to think if anybody else from the university other than him came to visit me in the hospital, that is to say, in an official capacity. I honestly cannot recall the head coach or any of the coaches or the trainers ever coming to see how I was doing. Howard Wilkinson showed up with a basket of goodies, a little peanut booklet, and that picked my spirits up and anchored me more deeply in my faith and in the life of this place. Helped me to tap into that deep inner reserves that, you know, made it possible for me to be resilient and go on and finish 3.5 years, and then from there to professional school, grad school, on to the faculty, and even to where I am now.
Thank you.
I think it's one over here.
Mm-hmm. Should be on.
Mm-hmm. Giving honor to God for being here truly. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here to celebrate this wonderful event. To Reverend Power, whom I adore so much, and distinguished panelists, and everyone who's here this morning, it's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for coming. I've written out a few things because I have a tendency to have a cluttered mind, and I want to make sure I'm focusing. So I hope you don't mind if I read a couple of things for you, and that way I can get everything in quickly. I had to pray over what I was going to say because the struggle has been there. But through it all, we are here today. The past. In 1974, a friend suggested I apply to Duke's grad school. I was reluctant, but applied. Came for an interview and was accepted into the PhD program in educational psychology with a major, with a concentration in intelligence testing. All the time I was teaching honors English at John F. Kennedy High School in Richmond, Virginia. I was elated when I got the acceptance letter, but my family was very concerned for me, and they said I was pricing myself out of the market. While my boyfriend at the time said I did not need a PhD and that he would buy me a Chevrolet Corvette Stingray. if I did not go to Duke. These concerns weighed very heavily upon my mind. But I had a strong desire, a burning desire, to do more for my students, especially the urban students whom I had been teaching for the past 4 years. But I had faith that I could make it at Duke. After all, Hampton University had prepared me with a Bachelor's of Science and a Master's of Arts degree. And my pastor, my home pastor, Reverend James Donald Ballard, one of the first in the Duke Divinity School in 1962, had always preached to me faith and that a belief in God will see you through anything. The second day of classes, my statistics class was a wake-up call for me. When a Caucasian woman said that I was sitting in her chair and that I should get up. That was a defining moment for me here at Duke. It was just 5 years after the Allen Building takeover here on campus, yet I felt that I did not belong. After all, I was one of the campus queens. I was a top sorority leader. I was always seen as a person who tried to do their best. And so that particular incident made me feel that this was not the place for me. But through it all, God placed angels all around me. Dr. Lucy Davis, my Caucasian, super smart, soft-spoken, steel magnolia, Nordstrom's wearing advisor, coached me, guided me, and respected me as I worked on my degree. Without her, I'm sure I would not have made it. My best friends on campus were the divinity students, supported by Dr. William C. Turner, for whom I also worked. Names like Dr. Virgil Lattimore, Gregory Davis, Bishop Cynthia Hale, all of those became my best friends here at Duke. Through it all, God placed angels all around me. I earned a degree in 3.5 years in 1978 with the approval of my favorite North Carolina governor, Terry Sanford, then president of Duke. I was hired as Dean of Minority Affairs, becoming the first Black woman to carry the title of Dean in Student Affairs, and perhaps even on campus. There were many challenges, including a name change from Black Affairs to Minority Affairs. Little did people know that it was a federal guideline that they offered the title to me before I even signed my contract to come to Duke. With my steady assistant, Linda Capers, the challenges came in waves, academically and socially. But I had to realize, as much as I loved the students, I was a part of the Duke administration, contractually, I was committed to also supporting the university. Members of the Durham committee, especially those in my sorority, asked me, what was I doing at Duke while the cafeteria workers and the maids here at Duke at the time always invited me, come to our church, you seem like a nice lady. And so I did. Chris and Edna from Trent Hall invited me to Mount Vernon Baptist Church, where I met Dr. Percy High, who was best friends with my minister, Dr. James Donald Ballard. And so the love affair began with the Durham community, who supported me greatly. All the while, weekly, sometimes daily, I would inch into the chapel, sit in the back, pray, and often ask God to just get me through this because my family and friends wanted me to succeed. They were concerned. They wanted me to succeed. But I accepted their concern as a challenge. The ministers in Duke Chapel became my supporters. Ben Smith, the choir director, often asked me to read the scripture. Reverend Williman, Bob Young, they all told me, Caroline, you not only read the scripture, we can tell you live it. I said, it's the only thing I have. As a poor Southern girl, it's all I have, and that was God. In the chapel, I found refuge, solace, and renewal that God's grace will bring me over and bring me through the challenges that were here for me. Yes, the ways have been watered with tears. But facing the rising sun, God allowed me to serve the students for more than 35 years here at Duke. That was my joy. That's my past. The present here at Duke, Duke has become so different in 2013 from the days that we saw the people, the environment of Duke in 1974. Bill Turner told us in a meeting, just keep in mind that Duke was made for the Southern aristocracy, the rich farmer's child, and that you have to make your way here, and you have to be strong. You have to do what is necessary. Ray Gavins, one of the first tenured black professors here, just before they hired me, when they asked me to come back from DC where I had taken a job, he said, Caroline, are you going to go for the big bucks? Are you going to come back to Duke and help with the cause? And so even today, there are still those all around me who are my angels, who give me support. I look at them from a distance and they don't realize I understand their struggle. And whatever happens, whatever challenges there may be today at Duke, and there are some, we still have a way to go. The critical mass of blacks are here at Duke. However, we still have a limited number of persons who actually have, as Bill Turner said, the permission to make decisions. In this Trayvon Martin generation, with a nation divided by political lines, with a black president who can still be on national television and be called out in Congress before millions of people worldwide, a liar, the nation still is a part of Duke. We have some work to do with relationships, interpersonal relationships, and of course, racial relationships. For the future, what are my hopes and dreams for Duke? Duke has been very good to me. Not only has it allowed me to serve the dear students whom I love so much, but they sent me worldwide. I have traveled as a part of the military around the world, approved by Pelham Wilder and Bill Clinton. They sent me everywhere. And every time I came back, I had an appreciation for America in particular, and also for Duke, for the people who afforded me these opportunities. And yet for the future, I ask those supporters, those angels, those students who have returned, who have big bucks, who also have a great deal of influence, let us work together to achieve mutual respect at Duke. The opinions and the scholarship of all people, especially our black community, must be respected. And to close, all I want you to remember from all of this is the struggle is still here in terms of mutual respect of scholarship and opinions. Thank you.
I guess the first shall be last. Is that the idea, yeah?
Yeah, go ahead, Doctor.
I am honored to be among the first and people who were here before me, which was the first issue with me at Duke was that some of the black community thought I was coming to reap in a field I hadn't sowed. The new day begun. It's a wonderful title because Macmillan in 1960, speaking in South Africa, said that a wind of change was blowing through Africa, What he didn't also say that window change was blown through America. All of the diaspora was in this state of change in the 1960s. It was in the 60s that I met my first African Americans as Peace Corps volunteers sent by John Kennedy. They came to my high school where we all came under the influence of Dr. Akano Ibiam, who was the first Nigerian missionary of the Presbyterian Church in Nigeria. Dr. Ibiam, being his senior prefect, I had to see him every morning after chapel. I learned through him that Christianity, the belief of God, the Jesus God, was a simple matter of believing in God, loving your neighbor, and walking in the faith that Jesus will be with you every day. So I struggle every day to live into the promise that says, I am with you always. And that struggle is an ever-present struggle. The struggle at Duke is simplified in the Christian message that Dr. Powery gave a few weeks ago. He said that you preach with your mouth shut. So preaching with your mouth shut is what you do in the academy as you try to live out a Christian promise. So with our mouth shut, we have served on the academic council, the executive committee at the academic council, and have been surgeon at Duke. The pleasures of being a surgeon are muted when you have to operate on your friends. John Hope Franklin put it in perspective when he said to me, I want you to operate on me, but I want you to remember I have 5 books to go. Okay. You know, the fascinating thing, of course, is that John Hope was 76 years old when we had to operate on him. So you can imagine the terror of having to operate on John Hope. Many years later, we celebrated the 5th book, which was his autobiography. He had said prophetically that he would finish those books before he passed. John Hope Franklin was not a Christian in the sense of being accepting of Jesus Christ, but he lived a life of example with the tenets of the Christian religion. Another friend who was John Hope would say, got to know inside, outside, was our friend, Dr. Walker. Dr. Walker was in pain at the airport when he called me one day and said, I'm boarding the airport, I'm going to Colorado Springs. I know you're gonna have to see you sometime, but I'm gonna go to Colorado Springs for a meeting today and I'll be back tomorrow. So he described what was going on and I said, if you think you must, go right ahead. And there was nowhere to stop him, of course, he was already at the airport. So he did go to the airport and I met him in the emergency room the next day. So urgent operation later, Dr. Walker was carrying the placard for the 1976 Olympics in Atlanta, which is his home. So praising the good Lord, I was looking at a man who was traveling in pain to go to a meeting. You talk about playing through pain. So that's an athlete who played with pain. His autobiography is a joint book with one of his friends, and it's entitled The Olympic Journey. I think a better title might be Playing with Pain. Duke has been a lot of joy and sorrow. The joys clearly overwhelm the sorrows. I want to conclude where I should have started, which is to say that on a day like this, we must remember the ancestors first. The ancestors on this stage included a lady called Edith King, whom our next speaker will recognize, Edith King, was the academic advisor at Hillside High School, who told this, three of his of these students who came to Duke to come here. And I think Mr. White and the audience remembers the name Edith King. I met Edith King at St. Titus Episcopal Church. And Edith King is one of those people that enabled the next generation. My hope for Duke is that we will find some more enablers. A real sorrow was when we were talking about faculty recruitment at Duke, we were always told that there was nobody to recruit. Show us the qualified people and we'll recruit them. Nobody was ever good enough for Duke. But out of that effort came examples of progress, like the Society of Black Academic Surgeons, who just formed here at Duke in 1989. And out of that has grown one new group of people in the pipeline, including our past chairman of surgery at Duke. So I have lived to see a black chairman of surgery at Duke, if you can imagine that. Duke was not the global university we're claiming to be in the 80s. We will get up in the academic council and talk about being a world-class university. So you could remind them gently at that time that we were neither in the world and the world was not here. And you cannot be a world-class university unless the world is here and you're in the world. So I guess we can change that conversation now and say, Duke is now a world-class university. We are in the world and the world is coming to Duke. So I want to conclude my comments by saying that my hope for Duke is great. Now that we're a world-class university, we have a new chance to lead and to listen to the world. This academic thing is a two-way street. We are going to have to learn how to learn from the world while we're teaching the world. So that's my greatest hope for Duke, is that Kunshin and medical faculties in Singapore will bring us the blessing of knowledge from abroad, from in the world, which is where the kingdom of God lives.
Well, everything I thought I was going to say has changed. And I think that is appropriate, because one of the things I've learned is to listen to the voice within. I thought when Alma finished that we should just stand up and say amen and go home. And then I heard you, and I heard you, and I heard you, and all I can say is amen. What flooded through as you were playing Alma were two songs. One you did not play and one you did. And the first was, "If it wasn't for the Lord, where would I be?" The second was, "Great is thy faithfulness. Lord, unto thee, all I have needed thy hands hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me." Now, how did I end up at Duke? And surely my faith sustained me. It was faith that brought me here. I think one has to remember that the civil rights community grew out of the faith community. It was the church, the faith community, that sustained, that nurtured, that protected the civil rights movement and gave it its theory and its philosophical grounding. And in 63, I came to Duke because we all had jobs to do in the movement. And for me, that was what I never intended to come to Duke. In fact, I was trying to get to Hawaii and the North and every place else. I was from South Carolina, and I was going as far away as I could. And my father was here at Duke. When you talk about faith, my father was in the first PhD class in the Divinity School. And he and Matthew Zimmerman would drive up together on the weekends. And Waldo Beach, who was my father's Christian ethics professor, said, "Reuben, don't you have a daughter coming out of high school?" My father called and said, "Just come up," because I was going to Oberlin, which was my father's divinity seminary. And he said, "Just come, because I, you know, you have to stay in good with your dissertation professor." I came up to Duke, and I fell in love with Duke. And I think that's a theme you will hear throughout the pain. You will hear a love for Duke, and for Duke in terms of what it can be, and what it has allowed us to feel and do and to be. And I came up and I fell in love with Duke. So I came first because I thought it was my job, it was my mission, it was my call. I think that if I'd heard someone play like Alma, I would have come to the chapel more often. I came occasionally, but not because it felt a little alien to me. But in terms of faith, I've said that my father was here. I'm the daughter and the granddaughter and the niece of Baptist ministers. And when I came to Duke, I reflect now that a part of me was a little upset because I had a single room. I'd asked for a double. They put all of us, Cassandra Smith, Mary Mitchell, we talked and said we'd all ask for double rooms. They were cheaper. And we all had single rooms. And as I reflected now, I think it was important that I had that single room because every night I got on my knees and I prayed. And there are other parts of, I'm glad you mentioned Howard Wilkinson. I think the faith community at Duke was very important. There are angels all around us. Howard Wilkinson found me. He got me involved with a religious council. I chaired a committee and so forth, and kind of looked out for you. And that was a very important part of my experience here at Duke. I think that one of the things that was most important was that when we came into Duke, I think we came in as people of faith. We knew who and whose we were, that in the midst of a situation that wanted to define you as less and other, part of the civil rights community, part of our growth within the church was an understanding that we were not defined by other people, but we were children of God. And it was that understanding that did two things. It sustained you in your sense of who you were, but it also opened you up to your relationship with others. And if you really believed that God was in you and in others, you had to move with people in relationship in a different way, and in a loving way, despite circumstances. And I think faith, my faith sustained me.
Before we open it up for Q&A, I wanted to see if there was anything else that any of you wanted to say in a minute or two, in a synopsis way, something that is on your heart, that in this public moment that you wanted to make your, in some ways, final remarks, even though in the Q&A time, you can probe further anything that any of the panelists have said to reflect deeper on it. So you'll also have further time to make further comments. But if there was one final statement, idea, something you wanted to emphasize before we open it up, I would love for that.
I'd like to take a try at that in a minute.
1 minute, yes, sir.
Yes, indeed. In my opinion, Duke is a remarkably different and better place than I found it in 1968. It was a place that was indulgent of diversity, and perhaps in that respect, somewhat tolerant. But it was better than a lot of other places. When I first went down to Clemson for a football game, the cheerleaders came onto the field, 16 of them. I counted each one of them, unfolded the biggest Confederate flag I'd ever seen in my life. And everybody in the stadium stood up to the playing of Dixie, including the Duke fans. And I looked around, and Ernie was there, and we only saw one other person, black, over by the locker room. That's the way it was. South Carolina would not recruit him. That's why he came to Duke. But what made it even an indulgent faith, a place, was this common faith that we did at least purport to share, black and white. A big challenge before us today is how we manage the great diversity that we see on this campus, the various ethnic groups, the many, many different faiths represented. I will be speaking in Bali, Indonesia in November on the topic of interfaith, freedom and interfaith, the interfaith community. And I'm wondering how we can manage now to bring people of many diverse faiths together to make Duke not only a great world-renowned academic community, but a great community, period.
I think that one of the things that has concerned me as we've moved through the 50th celebration is whether or not we use this as an opportunity to really be self-reflective, to think critically about where Duke is and what it can be, and to work to institutionalize aspects of the community so that it is not dependent upon who is president or who is the dean or who is in this position. But that Duke creates a culture in terms of its faculty, its staff, its administration, which will also support students, which really appreciates and values the full development and growth of each individual, is not just tolerant, but supportive, in which students don't just survive, they can actually thrive, and that we become known as a community that is not only excellent in terms of intellectual growth, but is engaged in the community and in which one finds the beloved community.
A day of absence. I thought about whether I should talk about a day of absence or not. In the 90s, there was a massive reviewing of the curriculum, and ultimately the result was Curriculum 2000. And many of us in the academic side of the university were in meetings day after day, a whole summer, as a matter of fact, 5 days a week. And we were reviewing every single course that Duke had, every single course. In that meeting was Martina Bryant, Dean Martina Bryant, and myself, along with many others. We would give our opinions and state our facts. And many of you know Dean Bryant, who is a tremendous analyst, a serious, critically thinking dean. And as we reviewed the curriculum, there was a feeling on my part that many were not listening. And it was a tough day in the third week of about 10 weeks. And the next day, I came in the meeting, sat down with my little books, and I looked around, and I noticed that Dean Martina Bryant was not there. I said, something is wrong. I packed up my books after 10 minutes and went downstairs to her office. And we talked about the lack of respect for our opinions. And so it was a day of absence for us. The word spread. people came to talk with us. The next day, because of Dean Bryant, there was a serious change in the environment of that meeting. People started listening and questioning and engaging us. And that's the day of absence for us. I look forward to the day when Duke, as I've said before, respects the scholarship of everyone, respects the opinion and the experiences of all. There are many who do, don't get me wrong, but there are few who don't. And so I look forward to the day when I don't have to say that, the day of absence.
I see medical grand rounds are over, and the real Dr. Aquari is in the audience. I want to remember that we were recruited here by Dr. David Saveston, who was the chairman of surgery at Duke in the 1970s. He came to the Mayo Clinic as the distinguished visiting professor and came to the lab where we were working and asked if I would come give conference here and to give a surgical research conference. After we went home, he wrote a letter saying he wanted to add to his department and would we consider a position at Duke. So in the meantime, and Dr. Aquari and I were engaged to be married, so we made our visits to Duke to look two more times. And on those visits, we're reassured that we could survive in Durham. So 35 years later, and a grandson present since September 20th, we're happy we came back to Duke. I want to add the comment that this space, the Duke Chapel, was the basis of my father saying that we should come to Duke. In his opinion, the presence of Duke Chapel in the middle of the campus was my assurance that no matter what, Duke would always come around to doing the right thing, he said. So I think that if you look back on the history of this institution, we've always managed to somehow come back and do the right thing. It's belated sometimes, but eventually we do it. So that's the nature of the institution. And my hope is that we'll continue to be that institution in the future, that in the future we'll continue to do the right thing.
Well, what we would like to do at this moment is to really open up the space for further conversation, for questions and answers. There is a microphone here. You don't have to be shy to make your way forward, but all of this is being videotaped and recorded, so it's for archival purposes in the history of the university. So we invite any of you who may have a question or a comment to come forward to the microphone, and Reverend Keith Daniels, who has been the program director for the entire 50th commemoration events, will facilitate this particular moment in time. Okay. Let's welcome Reverend Daniels.
Again, good morning, everyone. This is probably the hardest role to step into given what we've just heard. I feel like there should be a long moment of reflection and silence before we rush the altar. But God's faithfulness has certainly been revealed in what we've heard. So I would like to invite you all to please applaud once again our panelists. And and also to Reverend Dr. Luke Powery, I'm just honored to celebrate his stepping into this grand space and leading our university chapel as the first African American dean of Duke University Chapel. So I'd like to applaud him as well. Uh, We did get started a few minutes late, and the next event on our schedule for the commemoration weekend is a meet and greet time at the new Mary Lou Williams Center, which recently moved into the space here in Page Auditorium, just to our right outside of the entrance. And that starts, it's set to start at 10:30. So I want us to be mindful of that, that time. As you come forward to ask your question, and I do invite you not to delay, this doesn't look like a shy group, but the microphone is here, and I invite anyone up at this time to pose a question to any one of our panelists. So please come forward.
Good morning, everyone. I'm never shy. I'm Fredessa Hamilton Cobb, new doctor, Dr. Fredessa Hamilton Cobb, class of 77. And I'm standing here to, first of all, thank you all for being here always. You have been a long, long part of my life and many others as well. I think I want to make a comment versus a statement. I will say that if it had not been for the modern black mass choir, I would have lost my mind. The beauty of the modern black mass choir and also the beauty of black churches here in Durham, North Carolina, is that we never felt that we only had one place to go to worship when we were at school here. There were buses being brought from churches, Fisher Memorial, all kinds of churches around Durham to come and get us and to help to make us part of the Duke community. And publicly, I want to thank them for doing that for us. And I also want to say that one thing about black students at Duke is, if it isn't already here, we create it. And I appreciate that opportunity, and I hope that undergraduates also still feel that way, that if it isn't already here, somebody started, and the rest of us will join in. So I do want to say that, and just to say again that the modern black mass choir was an important part of my faith and sustaining my faith here, because we really did stick together as a family. And so we have our Duke black community family, and then within that, we had that other family. And if it had not been for that, I'm not really sure where I'd be right now. Thank you.
I want to take this minute to add just a little history. During my undergraduate years, an attempt was made to try to get that choir going. One of the first gatherings was over in Southgate, but then another one down here in the basement of the chapel. But it was Wilbert Mickens, Alma's brother, who really brought a spark to help get that choir going, and I just wanted to lift his name up right now. So it runs in the family.
Good morning. My name is Elena Riggins, Trinity class of 90. To echo what the previous lady said, that if we didn't, as black students here at Duke, if it was not here, we definitely helped create it. I did not attend chapel services that often here, but I am grateful for Duke because Duke allowed us to establish Rapture's Christian Fellowship at the time when I was here on campus. And if I would also add that if it had not been for the Black Divinity students helping us get through Duke, we wouldn't have gotten there. I was also a member of the Modern Black Mass Choir, and we had an advisor from the Divinity School. Also, the leader of the Raptors Christian Fellowship was also a minister with the Divinity School. And so I believe there's a great presence of African Americans in the Divinity School, and it would be great to have a greater presence in all of our graduate schools and in our undergraduate levels as well. But to echo what the lady said, had not been for our black students in our Divinity School, many of us would not have gotten through Duke as we did. Thank you.
I just want to say, as people coming up, the mass choir is wonderful. I remember coming back after a couple of years to something over, I think it was in the Bryan Center, and the choir came and I said, "What?" You know, like that. And there was a woman who played the tambourine. She was so good. I went back home and I told my husband, who wanted to know what I wanted for Christmas. I said, "I want a tambourine, Ed. I want a tambourine." So I did get a tambourine. They don't give tambourine lessons, so unless you got it. But I do have the tambourine. It reminds me of that choir, and that they were absolutely superb.
I am Anne Michaud Aquari, and I'm really sorry that he mentioned me. But that causes me to come and make a couple of comments rather than a question. I'm sorry. When my husband started, back before he started, I still find it remarkable that Dr. David C. Staveston recruited Onye and recruited him so hard to be the first in an invasive medical specialty. But whatever it was that brought him to the point that he thought that surgery should be integrated, he certainly made it, did just a tremendous number of things to make sure that we would succeed. I think, of course, the first thing that made sure we would succeed was the level of training and the temperament that my husband brought with him. And I'll tell you, I was very, very nervous the first time he was on call. And he got a call and went off to the Duke emergency room to take care of a patient who was unlikely to be black. It was a very nervous night for me. But one of the things that was remarkable to me about Onye, and that I hope all of us can try to emulate, is despite the experiences, the kinds of experiences you've heard about and probably all of us have experienced, there wasn't bitterness. And in some way, he was able to, I guess what he said, or what Luke said, what was it? To pray silently, to let your actions speak. So he did that. But I think what is a wonderful, to me, story that tells the transition that Duke has made, the transformation, is Skip Gates. If you were here at the time that Skip Gates was here, the venom was, I guess you can't palpate venom, but you can feel it. And some really negative things happened at that time. And Skip didn't need to stay here, so he didn't. But I think it is just a wonderful thing about this university that earlier this year, we brought Skip back and celebrated Skip. It is a remarkably different place from what it was in 1978 when we came. It was a remarkable university then, and it's a much more remarkable university now. And I am, having finished my house staff training here at Duke and having gotten a law degree here at Duke, I am honored to have that credential on my curriculum vitae.
I'd like Keith. I know we're running out of time, but I feel like now I was asked something pressing on my heart, and this is really, really it. Duke is a remarkable place, not just because those of us who are African American can claim positive experiences in the long run, but the entire university is the better for some very courageous black student leadership in the late 60s and early 70s, but particularly the late 60s. Some of those folk sacrificed to the hilt. They never got their degrees. Some of them would not dare come to this campus now because of the pain and the hurt that they feel. One went crazy sitting next to me one day in the dining hall. May God forever watch over him and all of those, and I would like for us to take at least 5 seconds and just be silent to honor those who helped to make this moment possible. Thank you.
We'll take just two more, given our limitations on time, so please come forward.
Thank you to the panelists. My name is James Williams. I'm a graduate of the class of 1973, and I was speaking with another class member, Fred Williams, this week, and I mentioned to Fred that I asked if he was coming to the 50-year commemoration services. And I said, by the way, this is also the 30-year anniversary of our class. And Fred said, no, man, that's wishful thinking. This is the 40-year anniversary, which, I mean, he's right. But at any rate, the university has changed for the better in significant ways over that period of time. But, you know, our society has changed in significant ways also. And I want to pose a question, and it relates to the role of a university, not just as an institution for learning, but also the possibility and its role as an agent of change. Because what we see in the 50 years since 1963, there has been remarkable progress for a segment of the black population. We see more people in middle classes. We see more people running and being a part of Fortune 500 businesses. We see more PhDs, but we see more people mired in inescapable poverty, in situations where there's a significant loss of hope, what Michelle Alexander calls the caste system of America. What role, if any, and maybe this is something that will be discussed some this afternoon, does an institution like Duke, with the tremendous resources, not just financially, but intellectually, to try to, you know, change this reality that exists today?
One or two may quickly respond to that.
Well, of course, there's not enough time to really go into that to the extent that I would like, but my short answer is to become the paradigm. Duke is a laboratory for the way in which humans can grow and learn to live together excellently, regardless of race or class or ethnicity or gender. I've often said that in the life of a university, there is no truth greater to learn than the truth of human worth. And if you ever get that by way of mathematics or physics or history or English, then you're really on to what the university is all about, and that is mutual respect. We have an opportunity to lead the world in ways that we can demonstrate that we have learned how to respect one another regardless. And all the policies and all the practices and all the procedures and all the results can reflect that. We are now truly a world university. We have opened a campus in China. We're in Brazil. It's the case now that the sun hardly ever sets on Duke, wherever Duke is. We have a wonderful opportunity to show the world how the world can live in a very qualitative way. I'll stop there.
My name is Jenna Ray McNeil. I'm a history professor at the University of North Carolina, waiting for the booze. No, okay. I wanted to raise a question about faculty, and before I raise the question, I briefly wanted to say that John Hope Franklin was my professor, and he would not have been alive to teach at Duke University had it not been for Dr. Okwari. Duke has moved from the 1930s, when there was one white professor in sociology who brought my mother, a graduate of Fisk University, in to do some research and let her teach one class of an introductory sociology class, at which time he was reprimanded and chastised, et cetera, to having John Hope Franklin building and having John Hope Franklin serve as a Duke Distinguished Professor. So I'd like to hear more about the African-American faculty, your desires for that. Were there particular areas that in which you wanted African-American faculty, and then how you moved to make certain that you had more than tokens? And I'll go back to my seat and take the answer.
Well, I'm trying not to let this just be a Howard Thurman silent moment thing and expect you all to get it, so I'll just pick up the mic again. As a member of the Board of Trustees, I and others are very, very intent on making sure that we do more than honor a policy on the books, that we actually do make it happen. Years ago, I was on at least two committees charged to recruit black faculty to Duke University, and some of you all in here are also on similar committees. I remember saying at one point in time that when it came to Duke University, there was absolutely no excuse at all for Duke not to have as many black faculty members as the university could stand in terms of its needs, in terms of the needs of its curricula, because we have the resources. There used to be the saying, well, we can't find qualified folk. I said, yes, you can. They're all over the world. And I remember at one point in time when I was on the faculty and serving as administrator at Howard University, I said, you can come there and find a whole passel of them. And that still remains true. It's a matter of the will. So it's a matter that I think we all have to keep pressing. It's a part of this becoming the paradigm thing. It's always making sure that we're vigilant, that we are always at our duty stations, calling people to do the right thing and never letting up, and then celebrating the results. With respect to black faculty here, you know, I have that long-term perspective, as some of you all do. Back during that day when we had, when I got here, Sam Cooke was here. And it was only a short time before then that he wasn't here. When you came, he wasn't here, right? Is that what it was? He was not here. Now, why am I pointing that out real quickly? Because of the personal experiences we had at that time. I had a faculty member in the Department of English say to me one day as I was leaving his class, stopped me at the doorway and said to me in my face that blacks cannot write. And then said to me, especially black boys, that's how he put it, cannot write. Now, to tie this into my faith statement, God is simply wonderful. God has a sense of humor, too. About 3 years later, I was 23, I was in charge of the summer transitional program for entering freshmen. That same professor came to my office and asked for a summer job. I prayed over it, and after I had prayed over it, the angels instructed me what to do. I set before him a list of conditions. And he agreed to every one of them. and I hired him. Well, that was a small thing indicating the great need we had for people who were in much more powerful positions than I was in right then in the way of black faculty. And Bill Turner, I have to cite you for all the great work that you did in that regard, but I would just encourage all of us to never let up on this. This is not something that we can ever, ever become easy about, so I would say press, press, press on beyond the sense of tokenism.
Say a couple of things. It is so important to have black faculty here, and one of the things that I thought of is a part of it is respecting people. I think Duke has to get over itself. There are many, many qualified people. It's also about respecting people's discipline, what they think is important to study. And one of the things that can occur is that black faculty can challenge and support black students in ways that are very powerful and important. So it's important not just to have black faculty, but black faculty who also have a mission and a commitment. And I was thinking about Sam Cook when you were speaking. He came, I think I was a senior the year he came, and he was in the political science department. I was in political science. I did my senior honors paper on a history subject. Professor Leach was my advisor. And when the committee met, they had asked Dr. Cook to sit on the committee. I had not had any contact with him prior to that time. And so we began, and they began the inquisition and so forth, and I was doing okay. And he just started in on me. You know, we laughed about it. He would say, but what do you mean by this, Miss Rubin? Da-da-da-da-da. And I kept thinking, hey, you're supposed to be my buddy. You're supposed to be helping me, and you're just kind of pushing me through. And later on, we were both on the board of trustees. And the question then came up about black faculty, and I was on the board when we started the Black Faculty Initiative, and I talked about the importance of Dr. Cook pushing me and asking the tough questions and doing so, and he said, I did it because I knew you could succeed. I knew you could do it, and you performed brilliantly. And it occurred to me that I had not had anyone who really knew I could be successful. It was always a surprise to everyone. It wasn't the expectation. And the kind of mentoring that is possible when people believe in your potential. And I think that was what was absent for so many of us. Bill Turner, I love when I see him on that video when he says, hey, we were hot stuff. You don't recognize. We gave you the best of our community, Duke. Okay, we gave you the best of our community. And what we need are people who value and support, challenge, and help it become successful.
Amen. Well, with that, we thank you. Just don't want to stop, but we have to. Once again, I want to invite you all to visit the Mary Lou Williams Center for Black Culture right next door out here to the right, where there'll be a time for meet and greet. I want to thank my chapel colleagues for Adrian Adrian Cook, who has been so supportive behind the scenes and making this success today. I recognize Beth Gettysturkey as well, who's head of development here at Duke Chapel. And I'm proud to announce that an award is being established, or a position in honor named after C. Eric Lincoln, a ministry post here at Duke Chapel to have an intentional outreach to students who come from diverse communities. So I hope you'll look out for more information about that. You can visit the chapel website, and more information about that will be coming out. As Dean Powery mentioned, we do have a few other esteemed firsts here. Gene Kendall, if Gene, you'll raise your hand, and Nat White Jr. Are with us. Dr. Turner is here, and tomorrow afternoon at the Durham Performing Arts Center at 1:30, Dr. Turner will be on the platform with four other distinguished Duke alum, and actually an NC Central alum, the Superior Court Judge Elaine Bushfan, but Dr. Brenda Armstrong, as well as Nat White Jr. and Joyce Johnson will be on a panel tomorrow at the Durham Performing Arts Center. You don't want to miss that. Not only that, our esteemed pianist today, and I'd like for us to again recognize Miss Alma Mickens-Jones. She will also play again tomorrow at the Durham Performing Arts Center. You don't want to miss that. We're going to celebrate what the community of Durham has meant to all of us as Duke alums, and it was recognized today in terms of the faith community and many others. And so I hope you will be there. For more information, just come talk to me if you haven't already seen the information that's available. Yeah. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And amen. Y'all have a good rest of the morning. I look forward to seeing you.